I'd like to welcome you again to Faith Reformed Baptist Church. We're continuing our study in the book of Romans, and Lord willing, this will be the last message in Romans chapter 9. Been there for quite a while. Did I hear someone cheer? We've been there for a long time. But we'll see what happens. We'll see whether we're going to finish or not. I would like to once again read the scriptures that we had in our reading this morning already, and I'm going to then give a very brief account of what we've gone through already. We'll begin in verse number 22. And of course, Paul is now answering a question concerning the Jew. All these questions came up when the idea that more Gentiles were being saved than Jews. And of course, the question was asked, had God cast away his people? And the answer was, God forbid, of course he did not. And in his explanations, he comes down to this, and he begins with more answers. What if God, willing to show his wrath and to make his power known, endured much long-suffering the vessels of wrath, fitted to destruction? And why would not that be good? It is good that God endured the vessels of wrath. And why should he do that? Because he wanted to have mercy, and that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy which he had afore prepared unto glory. Even us. Now notice that Paul was a Jew, but he said even Gentiles, but he said us. That means believers, whether they're Jew or Gentile. They are the vessels of mercy. Jew or Gentile, the vessels of mercy are the believers and the ones who have rejected God, or the unbelievers. They're the ones who have been called here the vessels of wrath. Even us who is called, not of the Jews only, but also of the Gentiles, as he said in Hosea, I will call them my people, which were not my people. And we said last week that these are the Gentiles that received the word of God while the Jew was put into dispersion, the 10 tribes scattered abroad, and the word of God scattered to the wind. But where that word went, where the people went, there in that place, they were called the children of the living God because they received the word of God. And so that's the lesson that Paul is saying. Those that receive the word of God, they are the children of God, and we are called his people. You're not, he said, those of you that were not my people, they shall be called the children of the living God. And again, Isaiah also cries concerning Israel, though the number of the children be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved, a very small number, a small number of believers. These would be the seed once again planted to make the next harvest. But all those unbelieving Jews who are spiritual Gentiles, unbelieving Jews are spiritual Gentiles, and believing Gentiles are spiritual Jews. And so once again, we have the reiteration, the understanding that the believers are the true Israel. The unbelievers, they're the true Gentiles. They're the ones without God. And the remnant shall be saved. In other words, has God cast away his people? God forbid, he has not. And they have been established to be his people. Whether they be physical Jews or whether they be physical Gentiles, the spiritual Jew shall be saved. For he will finish the work and cut it short in righteousness. This has to do with the idea that when Christ came, all the generations and the years of preaching about the coming of the Messiah, it was completed and finished, and the gospel was wrapped up and put a bow on it and delivered to the world. And it was cut short right then, and God said in his Son, it is finished. And as Isaiah said before, except the Lord of Sabaoth. Now, if you don't know what that means Lord of hosts. That means Lord of a lot, very many. Except the Lord of very many had left us a very small number, a seed. Now that's a contradiction. That's the way Paul is saying. He is the Lord of so many. And yet if he had not left us just a little bit, we would have been like Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, he's describing the condition of the physical Jew at the time, because the question was raised, has God cast away his people? And he's been answering it over and over again with different shades of truth added to each answer. Now we come to verses 30 through 33. We begin with this. What shall we say then? In light of all the arguments he's given, he's going to give us even more. He's going to tell us even more about the Gentiles and the Jew. And I want you to pay attention to the word righteousness here. And I want you to consider this. How do we relate to God in our relationship? Do we have a relationship with God in unholiness or holiness? In unrighteousness or in righteousness? Well, the answer is, his people have a relationship based upon righteousness. Now we have to decide, is it your righteousness or the righteousness of Christ? That's the question. And so let's read these verses. We'll get a simple understanding, and then I want to drive home one particular point. Verse number 30. What shall we say then? That the Gentiles, which followed not after righteousness. So let me stop right there. Remember how he said, what advantage hath the Jew? Much in every way. To them were given the oracles of God. They were given the rules of righteousness. Now the Gentiles were not given that. And so with that in mind, that the Gentiles which followed not after righteousness, because they were not given the rules to follow, the precepts of righteousness. But remember how Paul stated it in the first few chapters of Romans? He said, within a man's heart there is the work of the law. The work of the law is the conscience saying, you're wrong, you're wrong, you're guilty. Because we know when murder happens, it is wrong. Even though we did not receive the oracles on the tablets as Gentiles, we still had the work of the law. But the writing of the law, where we love the law, was not done until the Holy Spirit pressed upon us the seal of his own Son to make us like him to love the law. But the work of the law was the guilt. Therefore, when the Gentiles were presented with the gospel, now we begin to read again, and hath attained to righteousness. Well, how did they attain righteousness if they didn't even have the law? What did they do? They heard the gospel because they were still convicted of sin because of the work of the law in their hearts, because every man knows that there is God and that he is righteous and that we are not and that we are guilty. Why? Even the righteousness which is of faith. And that is going to be the big difference. That is going to be the difference between those who are spiritual Jews and those that are spiritual Gentiles. No matter who you are, and we have a wide variety of people here, of many races, ages, economic status, it doesn't matter who you are and what you've done and where you come from. It only matters that if you have faith in Christ Jesus, who has the righteousness revealed from heaven to give to those who have need. And that's going to create a stumbling block for some. And that's where we're going. Even the righteousness which of faith. However, here we go. Verse number 31. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, remember they were given the oracles. They were given, and they followed after that. They have not attained to it. They have not attained to the law of righteousness. Why? You can't. Sinners cannot obey that contract perfectly. They're unable to. Unable to because they do not want to. They do not have the heart to do it. Now, let me read it again. But Israel, which followed after the law of righteousness, hath not attained to the law of righteousness. They're unable to do that. Even though the Gentile was able to do it. Why? Because it was given to them as a gift. Given to them because that righteousness was revealed from heaven in Christ. And when you believe in Christ, you are in Christ, you have that righteousness. And against such there is no law. Remember what the scripture says. Against such there is no law. Now, verse number 32. Wherefore, because they sought it not by faith. Now, there's going to be a big difference here between faith and the deeds of the law, the works of the law. And that's going to be the gist of my message when I get done reading here. Wherefore, because they sought it not by faith, but as it were by the works of the law, they wanted to offer their deeds to God to justify themselves on the day of judgment, rather than to depend upon the imputed gift of righteousness from Jesus Christ. They would rather have their own defense than the defense of Christ. That's the stumbling block. For they stumbled at that stumbling block. It's a great stumbling block of pride to say, I want credit where credit is due. And I want to be recognized when I've done right. And I'm ready to go to court. And I'm ready to stand before God to make sure everyone sees what I've done right. There's a problem with that plan. A severe problem. And as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone and a rock of offense, and whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. Now, before we get to that scripture, that is a quotation from Isaiah. As a matter of fact, it's a quotation to two different places in Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 8 and Isaiah chapter 28, but it's not from one place. Paul actually combines two different verses together. Never seen it done. This is the first time I've seen where the Apostle Paul actually takes two different verses, ties them up together, and says, this is what God has said. We'll get to that point later. Now, I want to describe this offense. You all know what it's like to be offended. You ever been offended by someone? Yeah. Have you ever offended someone? You all know what that's like, right? There is a rock of offense. Who do you think was offended by this rock? Well, you might think, well, if anybody has a right to be offended, God has the right to be offended by us. But in this case, there is a rock that should not be offensive to anyone. The rock of Jesus Christ, whom, when we are going to go to Isaiah, we'll see that this rock is a cornerstone that's used as a foundation for the church of Jesus Christ to be built upon. And all judgment will be based upon the merit and the standard of our Lord Jesus Christ. And there is in Christ that perfect righteousness. Now, why would that be offensive to some? Why? Well, if you wanted to have your desserts, if you wanted to be recognized for all the things that you did, all the things you denied yourself, all the times you went to church, all the time you listened to those boring preachers, all the time that you went to this and that, if you wanted to be given credit for that, you also have to take all your sin to go with it too. Now the question is, are you willing to be judged for your sin in order to be given credit for all the things you want people to see? There were people at the time when Christ was in his flesh and he came to die for us that they really wanted to have their righteousness to be admired by others, the Pharisees. However, that was torn away by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they didn't like that. They didn't like that. They would rather have gone to God, making him obligated to justify them because they felt that they have done the deeds the law requires. Now, that's the idea of the offense. Christ is the rock. They were offended by his person and by his work. The offense is they chose their own righteousness. They want to approach God in their own righteousness to make their defense based upon what they have done rather than to trust in Christ for his righteousness. That's why they were offended. Now, I'm going to present an idea here to you. We have talked many times about the word covenant. Old covenant, new covenant, a covenant between God and man. I'm not going to use that word today. I'm going to take a different word and use it in its place, the word contract. Because we today have we know what a contract is. We don't ever say, I'm going to build my house and I'm going to hire a plumber and make a covenant with him. You know, people don't talk like that. They don't make a covenant with a plumber. They get out a piece of paper, they write down what they want done, and they put a price down, and then the plumber, they kind of deal back and forth. The price, the time, the labor, everything. Everything has to be done according to coffee is done, you know. It has to be done according to the contract. And then you sign it. Now, when it comes to a contract, what makes a real contract? There are really just three basic things to it in every society. If you go on your website and you kind of look up the word contract, you can go to Australia and Germany and England, United States, and they all have their own definitions of what a legal contract is. But they all contain three basic things. Number one, you have to have some kind of offer and some type of acceptance. So when you go to Walmart and you look at things on the shelf, you are engaging in a contract because they're offering things at a certain price. And you're accepting to pay that. When you go up and you put your money down, they give you a receipt. Signed, sealed, delivered, contract done. You do it all the time. An offer and an acceptance. Now, sometimes people get confused about the gospel. They think, that sounds like the gospel. He's offered and I've accepted. I got a contract with God. And everyone feels comfortable with a contract. You know why? Because it creates obligation. Now, there's an offensive thing in here somewhere, because if you had a good friend and he said, you know, I'm going to come over and help you with that plumbing job you have, and then you say to him, can I have that in writing? You know, how would that make him feel? I offered my help. I offered out of the kindness of my heart to give you assistance, and you want it in writing? Maybe I am busy. You see, but when it comes to people you don't know, you want something in writing. And you know what the difference is? Trust. Trust and obey. There's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But if you don't trust, get it in writing. Have a covenant. Have a contract. Now that's one element, an offer and an acceptance. Now the next thing is an intent to enter into a legal relationship. In other words, you want to actually say, I want you to understand, and I understand that we have made an obligation to each other legally, and that's going to be our basis of business. It's not personal. This is not personal. This is business. You know, so that when the bank comes and takes everything away, they're going to say, you know, it's really not personal, but I got to take everything. And when someone takes your car, it's not personal. It's not like I don't like you. I just need your car. Every time a contract is enforced, when someone breaches a material condition, you see those words? Sound like a lawyer, doesn't it? When someone fails to meet a material condition in a contract, then someone's going to enforce that contract, and then it's not personal. But you know what? The gospel is not like that. The gospel is personal. The gospel does not obligate God to us. The gospel, God is our friend, and he should be trusted with the promises he makes us. That's not the contract that people have with people. The last thing that every contract has is consideration. That's another legal term. You know what that means? I've said it many times from the pulpit. Quid pro quo. That's the extent of what I can remember from my Latin classes. It means literally this for that. Consideration is something that you offer for the other person to consider as a value. And then you exchange value. Sometimes you give money for service. Sometimes you give money for materials. Sometimes you work for service. Sometimes, whatever it is, something of value. They want it, you want it, you have something you want to exchange, and you say, consider this. And so when you have reasonable consideration, then you're on the road to having a binding contract. People like a Pharisee, who is unable to trust God at His word, want to not die and go to hell, but they want to have a method, a mechanism, a contract that says, make me an offer and I'll accept it, depending on what you want in consideration. And let's understand that we're both bound by it. Now, I've mentioned everything that has to do with a legal contract. Adam had that. Not Jesus Christ. The covenant between God and His Son, Jesus Christ, is like that. But we being in Christ is not like that at all. We've been given a gift, and God has promised it. It is not a contract where you can defend yourself in court based upon your accusation that God has breached a material condition. He said, if I kept the law, I don't have to go to hell. Well, I'm here to defend myself. I've not killed, I've not done this, and my favorite of all, there's a lot worse than me, like Hitler. You know, it seems to me like the only condition to go to hell is to be worse than Hitler. That's the only thing you have to do. If you're worse than Hitler, then you can go to hell. However, to actually have within your heart and mind that you would take God to court, and whose court would you take Him to? Are you going to another court? You're going to His court. Now, I want to consider, with that in mind, now we've discussed what a contract is, I want to go to Isaiah, because he mentions this. He says, as it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense. Whosoever believes on Him shall not be ashamed. Now, he is addressing the problem that the Jew wanted to approach God with the works of the law and say, I want what's coming to me. Oh, if the sinner could only see the truth, he would never say to God, I want what's coming to me. They would never say that. Let's go to Isaiah and see what Isaiah had to say. We'll start with Isaiah chapter 8. I got the glasses on that require this, so I got to raise it up. In Isaiah chapter 8, we'll begin with verse number 11. Just a very brief background. Isaiah is prophesying about what's going to happen when the Assyrians come and take away the people of Israel. Now, they're debating on what to do. Maybe we should cut a deal. That's what they're thinking. Maybe we should have a confederacy with them. Now, we'll see what Isaiah says about that. For the Lord spake, this is Isaiah 8:11. For the Lord spake thus to me with a strong hand and instructed me that I should not walk in the way of this people. In other words, the people want to do something, and he's telling Isaiah, don't listen to them and don't you do it. Say ye not, a confederacy. Say ye not, cut a deal with the enemy. Say ye not, a confederacy, to all them that whom this people shall say, a confederacy. Neither fear ye their fear, nor be afraid. Don't be afraid of them. Who should you be afraid of? Who should you be afraid of? Well, I think he's going to tell you. Sanctify the Lord of hosts Himself, and let Him be your fear, and let Him be your dread. Sanctify the Lord. Set Him apart. Do not place your enemy in the place where the Lord should be. Don't try to cut a deal with them. You stick with God. And he shall be for a sanctuary, a safety place, a place where you can go and hide. Do not hide in your lies. I'll get to that later, but remember that I said that. Do not hide in your lies, but hide in the Lord, in the sanctuary. But for a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense to both the houses of Israel, for a gin, that's a trap, that's a snare, a gin and for a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken. Why? Because they will choose to cut a deal. You know what that is? To make a contract. They want to cut a deal and to make a confederacy with the enemies of God rather than to depend upon God. Now, let's go to to Isaiah chapter 28, and we're going to continue because that's what Paul did. Paul included information from this verse and information from chapter 28. Chapter 28, we'll begin in verse number 14 in chapter 28. Wherefore hear the word of the Lord, ye scornful men that rule this people, which is in Jerusalem, because ye have said, oh, this is an interesting thing, we have made a covenant with death. How many people have ever made a covenant with death? Now, why would anyone ever make a covenant with death? Just consider this. If you knew you were going to die, you would want to personify this idea, death, and cut a deal with them. How can you cut a deal with death anyhow? What can you do? Is not the death, sin is the sting of death. Sin, not the other way around. Sin is the sting of death. However, the strength of sin is the law. The strength of sin is the law. So what kind of covenant can you cut with death? Hey, if I don't break the law, you can't come for me. You can't claim me. You have no hold on me. And so people that make a covenant with death have decided to defend themselves using the law of God. Now let's continue to read. And they have made a covenant with death and with hell. Are we at agreement when the overflowing scourge shall pass through? You know what that means? When death finally comes. When the time comes, when death comes to collect, or shall we say, pass out his wages, because you've worked for death and the wages of sin and death, it shall not come unto us. That's what the contract, that's what the Pharisee says. Hey, when the time for death comes, they won't claim me because I have a covenant with them. For we have made lies our refuge. No one can prove it. You know, it's just, that's one thing that really strikes me odd when someone says, you know, I know you've done that. And then they reply, can you prove it? Can you prove it? Can it be proven in a court of law? Can you point it out? I know it's in my heart, but you can't read my heart. I know it's in my head, but you can't read my mind. I know what the truth is, but it cannot be proven to a judge. And when I go there, I'm going to defend myself. And when I defend myself, it's going to look good because it's always looked good. It's always worked in the courts of men. Always. But whose court are we in? Not the court of man. We are dealing with the one who knows the hearts of men. And the covenant with death is not the one you want to keep. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation, a stone. Now, it will not mention anything here about a stumbling stone, but it talks about a foundation and a stone of the church of God, where Jesus Christ is that foundation stone. He is the cornerstone upon which the entire building of God is built. And this building is going to be built precisely and purely and honestly with integrity. Listen to how it's described. I will lay in Zion a foundation, a stone, a tried stone, a precious stone, cornerstone, a sure foundation. He that believeth shall not make haste. I'm going to address that in my conclusion. Okay? He that believes shall not be ashamed. That's how Paul said it. But he shall not make haste. But for right now, judgment. You know what that means? When you go to defend yourself because you've made a covenant with death and you want to stand in the court of God, judgment also will I lay to the line. I'll lay it to the line. It will be precise. When God puts a level on his building and builds his church, he will make it level. He will make it true. And righteousness to the plummet. He'll make it completely plumb. Now, if you're any kind of a builder, you know what that means. It's straight up and down. It's straight horizontal. You put a level on it, and the bubble is right in the middle. It's going to be perfect. When God judges, it's going to be perfect. Not according to, can you prove it? It's not going to work like that. It's going to be just on the cornerstone of Jesus Christ. And where is it going to come from? The righteousness of our God. Not the righteousness of men, not because you want to have your desserts and you want to be able to be recognized for all the things you've done. Put that behind you. Do not let your pride stand in the way of being grateful for grace. It says, and hail shall sweep away the refuge of lies. And the waters shall overflow the hiding place where those who thought their defense was in their secret places of lies. And your covenant with death shall be disannulled, and your agreement with hell shall not stand. When the overflowing scourge shall pass through, then ye shall be trodden down in it. Is not going to work for you. There's going to be a material breach of contract with the law. And why did the Jew get rejected by God? Because they came to offer their works of the law and not by faith. That was why. Now, I want to say this. The Jew at this time represents any unbeliever who is religious and wants to be their own attorney and stand before God and justify himself. Now, there are unbelievers that are just atheists. Those are not the kind we're talking about. We're talking about the ones who have been raised in church, the ones who felt like, you know, I got way too much invested in this life. I've done way too many things that I'm admired for. To just throw them all away and to humble myself before God, and to be an admirer of grace, knowing that I don't deserve it. And that's where we have to see the big difference between having a contractual relationship with God or trusting someone who loves you enough to promise you that he will give you what you need. A righteousness revealed from heaven. That is the difference, folks. Now, this is the conclusion I want you to see. Let me go back to Romans. We read this again in verse number 33. As it is written, behold, I lay in Zion a stumbling stone, a rock of offense. And whosoever believeth in him shall not be ashamed. Paul merged those two verses together. And he said that there is this rock of offense where the self-righteous sinner who wants to represent himself based upon all that he's invested in this world and looking good and wants his just desserts as he has always received in this life because it was quite admirable. No one can see the sanctuary of lies that he is in. Only when death comes, will the flood come in and destroy the sanctuary of lies, and no more will he be able to say the argument, "Can you prove it?" Because God will judge the secrets of men. And all the sanctuaries of lies come tumbling down. However, they that believe, they that trust, remember, you don't go to someone you trust and say, "Put it in writing." No. But they that believe shall not be ashamed. Now, John Gill puts it this way. There's about four different ways of understanding this phrase, shall not be ashamed. Number one, he says, don't be impatient for the fulfillment of this prophecy. Those that believe, don't be impatient. What God has promised will come. Don't be ashamed. Don't let others embarrass you or antagonize you or give you any type of doubt. It will come to pass as the Lord has said. Another way that this can be, shall not make haste, that's how it's stated in Isaiah, but in Romans it says, shall not be ashamed. The same phrase means this: we shall be satisfied with what is provided. We shall not be ashamed, but we will be satisfied with the imputed righteousness of Christ, because we will become more familiar with the beauty of grace and not the pride of being given credit for what we think we deserve. But we'll be satisfied with a gift of saying, "I don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. I'm just glad that God had mercy upon me. And I am happy with that, and I am completely satisfied with it. And I know that it's coming one day. I will not be ashamed." That's what this phrase means. And it shall not be, we shall not be moved when trouble comes. That same idea, will not be ashamed. When temptations and trials and doubts come, we will not be moved by them. We'll not be ashamed. We'll not be confounded. We will not be brought to doubt or despair because our provision may fail. It will not. And what is our provision? The righteousness, the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ, not our own defense. It's been said that a man that defends himself has a fool for a lawyer. But never let it be said that a man who goes with Christ as his attorney, we'll put it this way, as his interceding lawyer, the one who stands, who is the mediator for his people, for the seed that believe. There is no doubt that there is only one way to God, and that is in Christ Jesus. And it's the idea that you trust. Do not think that God is obligated. But somehow people, they always want this, what can I do to make it sure? What can I do to make it sure? If you want that assurance based upon what you do, check that thought. Because you're asking consideration for consideration, value for value, you want to exchange something. Don't even believe that your faith is worth what Christ did for you. Just trust what he has done. Trust what he has done. Believe in God. Do not be tempted to desire conditions to give you an assurance. If I only knew, if I went to church all the time, if I only knew, if I did this, if you would just give me something to do that I can do, and then I say, I have done it, then I would feel so much better. You need to take your heart and your mind and take it off of what you can do and put it right on Jesus Christ and see what he has done. And base your confidence and all of your strength upon his strength. Do not recognize your strength as strength, because your strength, your righteousness are as filthy rags, and the salvation, that power that saves us, is not us, and it is God. Trust. That's what makes a contract not a contract. It is trust, faith in God. They did not seek it by faith, but God's people do. You need to increase. Now remember, in a contract, both sides have an obligation. You need to increase your obligations to God. But you need to also take all his obligations off the table. He's not obligated to you. Do you know who he's really obligated to? Himself and his son, Jesus Christ. He made a covenant with his son. And you know why he's going to save you? Because he promised to. He's obligated to his own integrity, not to you. You're a sinner. Why would he be obligated to a sinner? You know what he's obligated to you to do? Judge you. His obligation to sin is to judge. But if you're in Jesus Christ, then he will be true to himself and he will save you. Take the obligations that you think he has to you off the table and take all your obligations and you put your obligations to God and keep them on the table. This is the kind of relationship we have. And say, oh, this is all so one-sided. Yes, it is. It's really one-sided. And the more you see it, the better you are able to live that life, then the more beauty you're going to see of God. The beauty of his grace will be more real to you. And that's it. The beauty of God's grace. It cannot be broken because he cannot lie. It'll never be broken. We will never be ashamed of our faith. We will never be discontented because he fails to provide what he said he will. And so why are there some that are saved and some that are not? It has to do with whether you're going to offer the works of the law or whether you're going to trust in the imputed righteousness of Christ. That is the beauty of grace. Let's go to the Lord. Father, we want to thank you for your word.